Welcome to Eagle's Rendezvous. This is the Bible study ministry of Eagle's Communications. We seek to encourage as well as to facilitate Bible reading and Bible study, and welcome you to this session, which is the fourth session in our reflections on the book of Philippians. Earlier sessions are available online, and we trust that you may go to them if you wish to follow this series more closely. We would like to welcome you in making contributions to make this ministry possible. We are very grateful to you for all of your very generous contributions thus far, and invite you to continue in this trend of generosity so that this ministry can go on to inspire and encourage even more. Please follow the directions on the screen in your giving, and please pray with me as we make our gifts to God for this ministry. Please pray with me. God and our Father, we thank you so much for your love, for the expression of your love in Christ Jesus on the cross. And coming out of that sacrifice, Lord, we live our lives in accordance to your will and to your desire. Help us, O God, in the understanding of your word. Help us not just to be hearers of your word, but also doers of your word. So we give to you, dear Lord, what you have already entrusted to us, a gift that you have already showered upon us. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the way that you have blessed us. And in return, we give a portion of what you have first committed to us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. This is the fourth session of our reflections on Paul's letter to the Philippians. Let's recap. Written towards the end of Paul's life, this letter to the Philippians is intimate and tender. Recollections of love and support from the Philippians bring joy to Paul. He is effusive as he prays for them with gratitude. Paul goes on to assert his raison d'être, or reason for being. He declares, "For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." He then turns to address the conflicts amongst the Philippians. The highest example in resolving conflicts is the self-emptying of Christ. Paul urges the Philippian Christians, "Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus." It is the moral high road to which we aspire, but mostly fail to attain. Paul recognizes that we are all not perfect, but on the way to maturity in our faith. Paul then talks about a faith that is maturing. He encourages the Philippians, "Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his purpose." Paul chooses the word that is translated work, as in work out your salvation, which has the idea of bringing to completion. He is talking about our faith that is maturing, and a maturing faith is a process. He is encouraging his readers, don't stop halfway. Go on until the work of salvation is complete in you. We should not be satisfied with less than the full benefits of the gospel. Paul adds, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. The same verb is translated works and fulfill, which is always used to describe God's action, which is always effective. God's actions cannot be frustrated. They are always effective. They will never be incomplete. Whatever God begins, he brings to an effectual conclusion. The late John Stott points to the three tenses of salvation. He asserts that there is a past tense to the idea of salvation. So Paul writes to the Ephesian Christians that it is by grace that you have been saved. We have been saved from the penalty of our sins. And then Stott goes on to say that there is a present tense in the whole idea of salvation. As when Paul writes to the Corinthian Christians, the message of the cross to those of us who are being saved is the power of God. And then, again in his second letter to the Corinthians, Paul asserts that we are the aroma of Christ among those who are being saved. It's the present continuous tense, that there is a sense in which there is the ongoing work of salvation in our hearts. Thirdly, Stott points to a future tense in the use of the word salvation. Paul, in writing to the Romans, says, since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? There is that future tense. And so, there are three tenses to salvation. That is the past tense, in which we have been saved from the penalty of our sins. There is a present continuous tense in which you and I are being saved continually from the power of sin. And then there is a future tense, a salvation that we are looking forward to when we all shall be saved from the very presence of sin. In the light of that great salvation that God has achieved, Paul urges the Philippians to continue to work out your salvation. He writes in verse 12, Jesus gave his life on the cross so that we might be saved, fully saved from the penalty, power, and presence of sin. From now on to eternity, on our part, we need to work out your salvation, in Paul's words, which is to appropriate, to make effective the salvation that God offers. In other words, we have to receive or appropriate what God offers. By putting the verb at the end of that sentence in the original, Paul is placing emphasis. Hence, it should be read, therefore, with fear and trembling, your own salvation Work it out, for God is at work in you. Effectual saving faith results from the moving of two persons towards reconciliation. Jesus died on the cross in our place to make salvation possible. We, on our part, will have to open our hearts in receiving and in appropriating God's gift. Paul goes on to describe the evidence that we must display for faith that is effectual in our hearts. He gives five evidences of faith in our hearts. First, he tells us that if there is effectual faith at work in our hearts, there will be a growing faith. There must be increasing evidence of our walk with Jesus, that His Word and His Spirit are shaping our worldview, our attitude, our behavior. We cannot continue to be victims of the same habits and slaves of the same temptations and failures that shame Christ. If faith is a journey, there must be progress towards God. Secondly, Paul says that our lives must evidence fear and trembling. Paul encourages, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. This is not the trembling of the slave before his or her master, or at the prospect of punishment. Rather, it is the consciousness of our creatureliness and our powerlessness to live up to God's standards. It drives us to seek and to be reliant on God. We will have a mindset that is fearful that we would grieve God. When we really love a person, we are not afraid of what she or he might do to us. We are, in actuality, more afraid of what we would do to her or to him. A third evidence Paul points is that the Christian that has a growing faith is peaceable. He says in the 14th verse, do everything without grumbling or arguing. Paul's use of the word grumbling is unusual. It is a word that is especially connected to the rebellious uprising of the Israelites against Moses in their desert journey. It describes a low, threatening, discontented muttering of people on the verge of an uprising. By using the word arguing, Paul is referring to useless and sometimes rude disputing arising out of distrust. Paul is indicating that equanimity, a composure that arises from the confidence that God is in control, is the evidence of a growing faith in our hearts. Fourth, Paul says that a person with maturing faith is irreproachable. He says it this way, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. The words Paul uses point to the stance of a Christian. Towards the world, the Christian is to be blameless. In other words, we are to live in a way so as to be morally scandal-free. so that we can walk tall and speak without fear as children of God in a warped and crooked generation, in Paul's words. Before God and in the mirror, the Christian is to be pure. The word literally means unmixed or unadulterated. It describes wine that is unmixed or metal that is unalloyed. It implies motives that are sincere and without ulterior factors, so that our dealings with others are honorable. Fifthly, Paul points towards a clear witness for Christ in the world if we bear these evidences. He writes, "Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life." When we live in ways that honor Christ, we will become clear witnesses to Him, shining like stars in the dark sky, holding to and offering the word of life. The Christian offers and demonstrates clarity in a muddied world, honesty in a twisted world, and light in a dark world. Paul is indicating that if the Philippians will demonstrate these outward signs of a growing inward faith, Paul will be gratified that his life's work will have been completed successfully. In his words, "And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain, but even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from our faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you." So you too should be glad and rejoice with me. So, effectual saving faith involves two parties: God in accomplishing the work of salvation on the cross, and human beings in receiving the gift of salvation in faith and gratitude. Then, the evidence of a maturing faith in our hearts will be an increasing exhibition of growing faith, of a sense of fear and trembling, that we will be peaceable, irreproachable, and in so doing, we will become clear witnesses to the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul now turns to addressing Timothy and Epaphroditus, and he provides living testimonials to their faithfulness. Paul writes, "I hope in the Lord Jesus Christ to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare, for everyone looks out for their own interests, not those of Christ Jesus. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things go with me. And I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. The Philippian church sent Timothy to Paul in his imprisonment. Paul met Timothy on his second missionary journey, and the two of them got to be close co-workers. They were together in Philippi, Thessalonica, Berea, in Corinth and Ephesus, and also with him in prison in Rome. Timothy was associated with Paul in the writing of at least 5 New Testament letters. Timothy was Paul's emissary to the churches that Paul wanted to encourage but could not go himself. Timothy was a trusted messenger whose sole desire was to serve Paul and Jesus Christ. He had, in Paul's words, genuine concern for their welfare, quite unlike everyone else who looks out for their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. Timothy is the patron saint of those who are content with serving second fiddle, just happy so long as they can serve. Epaphroditus was sent to the Philippian church to convey a gift to and to remain to take care of Paul. He was Paul's personal attendant and risked his life to serve Paul. He was vulnerable and open to being charged along with Paul. Unfortunately, Epaphroditus fell ill and was near death with the notorious Roman fever, which sometimes swept the city like a scourge. Paul knew that Epaphroditus needed to return home at that point. But Paul was concerned that Epaphroditus may look like a quitter who abandoned his responsibility to look after Paul. And so, Paul gave him a very strong testimonial. He writes, "But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. For he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and almost died. But God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad and I may have less anxiety. So then, welcome him in the Lord with great joy and honor people like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ. He risked his life to make up for the help you yourselves could not give me." Using intimately collegial terms, Paul called Epaphroditus his brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier. They signal that Epaphroditus was one with Paul in sympathy, work, and danger. And then Paul uses 2 very significant words to describe Epaphroditus. First, he calls Epaphroditus your messenger. It is the same word in the original for the word apostle, which Paul uses here to implicitly rank Epaphroditus with him and all the other apostles of Christ. The perceived lowly work of an assistant is deemed by Paul to be that of an apostle. The second word that Paul uses is the word servant. The servant to take care of my needs. It is different than the word slave that usually refers to those who work for Christ. Paul calls himself a slave of Christ. But rather, this word here is referring to those who love their city so much that they would undertake civic duties at their own expense. These are benefactors who would defray the expense of an embassy or dramatic readings of great poets or the training of athletes or the paying of soldiers in a war on the behalf of a country. These are, in actuality, philanthropists who are generous and self-giving. Paul sees his personal assistant as one that is important as an apostle and as self-giving as a philanthropist. It is very moving to see Paul displaying such generous consideration for the welfare of a servant while he himself was in prison, awaiting judgment and in the shadows of death. In such a time, when his life hangs in the balance, Paul is concerned that his assistant should not be embarrassed on his return to Philippi. In the highest tribute, Paul says that Epaphroditus risked his life to serve Paul. He uses a gambler's word to mean to stake everything on the turn of a dice. It is serving without holding back. It is stepping out without knowing if there is a coming back. It is giving without considering what is left for oneself. I think of a priest in the cathedral here in our city who gave $980.56 when we were sending our colleague to London for theological studies in the 70s. This priest had emptied his bank account to match the desire of a young man who was emptying his future to serve Christ. Epaphroditus is one who is in the footsteps of the one who emptied himself of all but love and bled for Adam's helpless race. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? He had a reckless courage which makes him ready to gamble with his life to serve Christ. May I suggest some implications from our reading in today's session? First of all, I think that we are all works in progress. God's saving grace will continually bring about cleansing in our hearts and conforming our lives to the image of Christ. While we submit to God's power to change us continually in our hearts, we have also at the same time to learn patience while waiting to see more changes in other people. It is so common for us to remark cynically when we see an unbecoming behavior in a fellow Christian. How can a Christian behave like that? Maybe we should be a little more patient, because God is not finished with any one of us. That perspective, that God continues His work within us, is itself a work of grace that maturity in faith brings to us. Secondly, I am reminded of a little song that Joel Hempel wrote. It is a cute song with a rambunctious melody. He writes, "There really ought to be a sign upon my heart. Don't judge me yet, there's an unfinished part. But I'll be better, just according to His plan, fashioned by the Master's loving hands. He's still working on me to make me what I need to be. It took Him just a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth, and Jupiter and Mars. How loving and patient He must be, 'cause He's still working on me." You and I are a work in progress. As we expect and pray for God to be patient with us and invite God to patiently work in and with us, let us show the same courtesy to others who may not quite be where we are in the maturity of our faith. Thirdly, it seems to me that maturing in our faith must necessitate a moving from being crowd conditioned to being Christ conditioned. Paul had a countercultural perspective to perceiving the worth of Epaphroditus. He elevated Epaphroditus to the part of an apostle. He saw his responsibilities the same as that of a missionary or as one who is an appreciated servant of Christ. And we can do no less. That we have to be conditioned by Christ in seeing people not the way our majority see them in our society. That if they do not earn as much, that if they do not have as distinguished a background as we do, they are in fact no less persons esteemed by God and by Christ. If anything, this comes so clear in Paul's teaching right here in our passage for study today. God is patient with us because He is still working on us.
He's still working. Yeah.
Just a week to make the moon and stars. sign upon my heart. Don't judge me yet, there's an unfinished part. But I'll be perfect just according to his plan, fashioned by the master's loving hand.